Fans of the Horus Heresy and fans of Gunpla, thank you very much for joining me for a review of the M61A5 main battle tank Hardgraph by Bandai. So, following on from my unboxing video and my time-lapse build video of this impressive vehicle, I'm going to do an extended build review of this kit. This stage, normally what I'll do will be to review the model and the build, and then also review the tactics in game. But obviously this doesn't conform to the latter part of that review of having specific rules and tactics for use in Warhammer 40,000 and the Horus Heresy game. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to turn this into an extended build review, a model review. And this is because this is such a fascinating model in its own right. And I'm also going to do a bit of a strip down of the model because there are several components you can take away. I'm also going to spend some time talking about the design cues and the design features gone into this vehicle because they are very interesting. And having had it and looked at it a bit, there's lots of fascinating little features that have been pulled in from all sorts of sources to make this vehicle. So without further ado, let's have a look around this impressive vehicle. This is a 1/35th scale plastic model and it's a push fit kit as well. So in the main, the main construction doesn't require any gluing, but there are a few detail parts that do require gluing. Let's just look around it. So yeah, I mean, it is a big vehicle. It's very futuristic looking with this enormous turret with twin main cannons. It's got these sort of built up front panniers almost. You can see that the turret is set on the rear of the tank, and this differs from the majority of modern tank designs, which have a fairly centrally located turret, and I'll come back to that when I talk about influences of the design process. So I think it's safe to say with this model, all the main structural building is push fit. The only bits that you need to actually glue are the fine details. As you can probably hear from that peculiar sound just then, the tracks are rubber, so they do have a considerable grip. At the rear, the turret has got a turret basket, like a storage area, and then there are a pair of doors open that you imagine would open out. They don't actually open out, although you could probably convert the model if you had a very fine saw to do that. There's a pair of large exhausts on each side, so two twin exhausts. Then we've got armoured skirts on the sides and six road wheels, and then a sprocket wheel at the front and the rear of the tank as well. The turret rotates all the way around, and then the cannons also raise and lower as so. And the turret uses a sort of a socket tooth design, so you can take that off if you want. There isn't any internal detailing to speak of. However, you can see evidence in there of provision being made to motorise this kit. And indeed, if you do look on, if you look around on YouTube, you'll find some very impressive models that have been converted to motorise this tank. There's a quick look around. In terms of, so a couple of thoughts about the kit quality and the build. The kit quality is absolutely superb. It is very impressively molded. No flash to remove or anything like that. The parts were all well designed on the sprues. There are a couple of sprue attachment points which could have been slightly better located, but such as this one, but they're only very marginal. So let's have a look at some of the finer details of this kit. So let's just have a look around the track unit. So starting at the front, we have a pair of headlights. There's a headlight cover here that you can pose either in a raised position as this is, or a lowered position. However, if it's in the lowered position, it does need sticking. It won't actually clip in that position. The headlights have got clear pieces to go in there. I've not put them in there because that needs painting before they the backs need painting before they go in. And then we've got these ridges at the front of the tank, and I believe these are like pannier stowage, and these are removable, and we'll come to that in a bit. There are armoured skirts that run all around the vehicle. And if I carefully get this right, we have some foot plates that you can carefully drop down, and they all do that. Lots of lovely little details like the foot stirrup to climb up, and you can see you've got handholds and everything. I mean, given that this is a science fiction vehicle, a tremendous amount of thought has gone into the design of this kit. And if you've ever built a model of a modern military vehicle, or a military vehicle of past history, you will look at this and you'll see all these design features, and you will appreciate the care and thoughtfulness that's gone into the design of this particular model. It is very impressive. And for a science fiction model, I can't think of any comparable vehicle that's been made like this to such a high level of detail. I mean, there's a fire extinguisher in there, and then again we've got the foot stirrups going up the side of a turret to climb on. A set of smoke dischargers. I'll come back to talk about some of the fine details there in a little bit when I get onto the actual kit build. Oh, just lost a part there. I'll clip that back on and we'll talk about that, because that's one of the removable components. So on the top of the turret, we've got the main targeting array with a clear front. This visor can be raised or lowered depending on how you want to depict it. There's a pair of rubber sleeves for the main gun. Nice little attachment lug points here, which you would imagine would be used if one of the main guns has been removed. Got some antenna. This piece here, I believe this is supposed to rotate. And I think, I imagine that has been perhaps a periscope, a remote control periscope with perhaps some sort of thermal sighting or something that rotates. A heavy machine gun type weapon on the commander's cupola. There is a single position, which suggests a small number of crew, and that rotates as well. If you take that off, there is a seat inside. And then, as you can see, the actual cupola lid lifts as well. We've got this turret basket at the back, and we can see that we've got all this fine meshing, and these are all etched metal parts. There's a light machine gun for rear infantry defense. They've got all these cooling vents, a stowage box to the rear of the tank. And coming down the other side, these nylon cords are the towing cables for the vehicle, and they attach at the front and rear. And that's an example of several different materials besides the plastic injection molded parts being used in this kit. Actually, four distinct types of material used. And then coming around to the front, I mean, another nice little detail there with another lug. If you just go back around to the rear of the vehicle, again, you've got towing lugs here, so really lovely little details. And there's just a view of the engine exhausts. See the main turret mount there. There's a set of I think these are like generators. We'll have a look at those in a bit more detail. And then the pannier again. And then looking at the vehicle head on, firstly we see the main guns. Get the focus on those guys. Okay. They've got these rotated top sights. Heavy bore, I mean, these look like they're supposed to be sort of like about something like 150mm size weapons, big guns. And then we have stowed transit brackets for the main guns. Here we have the driver's cupola. And this hatch can be removed. And there is a position in there to seat the driver, although it's only a plastic stand. There isn't an actual detailed base as there was in the commander's position. And we've got these
I'm not sure what these are here. I'm not sure if these are some sort of attachment point, perhaps for a mine plough, or if it's some sort of extending feet to brace a vehicle if it's in a static position to fire from. But yes, a very, very impressively detailed kit. Oh, and a quick look at the tracks. So the tracks are made from rubber. These are two-piece assemblies. And if you recall, when I unboxed this, I came across a set of steel pins, and I said, I wonder if they were part of the running gear. Well, no, they weren't. The steel pins actually connect the two track sections together, so it's two per track. So yeah, very clever design, and certainly the smartest way I've ever seen these tracks connected. And there's just the underside detail as well. In terms of the actual build, well, as I say, most of the structural build, this push fit, and that was very straightforward, very enjoyable to do, really good fun. Not just, I always enjoy building my models, but this was fun to build. This kit also gives you a variety of different skill challenges as well, because as well as the push fit section, which is fairly straightforward, although there are some bits that are tricky. I mean, putting the main hull on takes some careful alignment, but in the main it's very straightforward. But then you have parts such as, let's find some examples, such as this radio antenna that needs sticking, and the various lugs they need sticking on, and you may find a pair of tweezers useful to help position some of these finer parts. So attaching parts like that, sort of like, you know, that's some delicate sticking work. And likewise, these machine guns are incredibly detailed, and they're multi-part, and they're actually so they need sticking together, and they're really quite fiddly to put together. However, saying that, they are beautifully detailed. And I think these are actually made out of a slightly different plastic compound because they feel harder than the main vehicle. I'm not sure, I might just be imagining that, but they do feel slightly different, and the detail is extremely sharp on those. And as I say, there's a heavy machine gun, which has got an ammunition bin there and a sort of classic style handle. And then there is also a light machine gun on this rear bracket. And again, absolutely beautiful detail. I mean, with this, you can lift the ammo belt, I think is it receiver. You could have that raised if you wanted. And then it's got this little optical sight on the back, and it also has a folded bipod. It comes with an alternative deployed bipod as well. So you've got some options with how you display that weapon. Then there's like a third tier of skill involved in building this, and this involves assembly with the additional materials in the kit. So for example, the assembling these nylon ropes, and these need to be carefully cut to the correct length. And then there's a recess on the underside of the towing lug to stick it in. And I use some super glue to stick that end in position, and likewise at the other end as well. And then the final type of parts, which are going to challenge you most skill-wise, are the etched metal parts. These are present in two areas. The first is the construction of the mesh and floor and the wall of this turret basket. The side panels, these are easy enough to do, I found. I mean, you know, I say that obviously it's more challenging than the rest of the kit. You know, and you want to be careful and only use small amounts of glue. I mean, I used super glue to stick these. They do actually fit very well. They fit really very well, and you don't need a lot of glue. And I found that the metal bonded very well to the plastic. So they were actually, once I'd got them all lined up and got the glue on, they actually stuck really well. Slightly trickier is the floor of a turret basket, which is here. And I'll tell you what, I'll just put the tank down to for a moment and take the turret off. There we go. Yeah, the floor of the turret basket. And that's a single piece of etched metal. And then at the end, this is part of the floor as well. So you have to bend this up at 90 degrees to get it into position. So you need to be careful with doing that. Now in the instructions, it said put these in first and then attach the rails. Now, I messed around with that, but I wasn't. What I actually did is I attached these first, and they're only push fitted, and they can actually take these off. I'm not going to now for sake of speed. But I actually built these, because there's several components, I built these push fitted them, and then I very carefully maneuvered the basket, the basket floor into position to make sure it fit, and to check that I got the bend correct on this end wall here. Once I'd done that, then keeping it in position, I secured it with a little bit of glue along here, just along this edge here, and the tiniest of dabs of glue just underneath here, and that held it. And what I then did is I removed this section. I'll tell you what, I'll do it just to show you now. Famous last words, this will be easy. There you go. So I then removed that, and it was stuck in position in a few places. And I then went around and carefully put small amounts of adhesive just under the contact points to stick it. And that worked really well, and I got a really good result with that. And I think as long as you're careful, the actual fit of the components is very precise. So as long as you're careful with your alignments, you're not going to have any trouble there, I don't think. Okay, there we go. So that's one place where we have etched metal parts. The other, and this is one which will really test your fine motor skills and gluing abilities, is the cap retainer chains on the smoke dischargers. Now, what you have to do here, and these are fiendishly tricky to do, you have like a tab that you have to stick on the underside. I'm trying to get, there you go. There's a tab, which is that rectangular tab that sticks on the underside, and then you have to bend the chain round and super glue the top tab onto the nose of a grenade discharger cap. There's four of those to do on each side. You will probably spend about a quarter of the amount of time just doing those as you will putting the rest of the kit together, if you choose to do so. However, the good news is you don't need to put them on if you're daunted by doing them. You don't need to put them on. Very easily leave them off. But yes, but I suppose that just goes to show the very fine level of detail that is present on this kit. And looking at it with the nylon cord, the rubber parts, the etched metal, the special plastic machine guns, certainly strikes me as being a premium product. And I imagine, although I don't know the history of the kit, this strikes me as being a bit of a special edition model, which actually sort of makes a bit more sense of a high price, having built it now and seeing the quality of the whole thing. Right, so the next stage is I'm going to tear the kit down to show you kind of like the how you can change the look of a tank. So let's start by removing these pannier boxes. And these just unclip like so, very easy to do. And when we do that, we reveal this storage area and we have a selection of tools. These are all, you stick all these on. You got a long metal spike, a spade, axe, pickaxe head, you know, the usual sort of gear you would expect to carry with a tank. You know, as a set of tank tools. Well, I imagine that. I've never seen a set of tank tools, but I'm guessing that's the sort of thing you might need. And then let's do the same thing on this side. Again, taking the pannier away. On this side, there's an internal stowage box that's been moulded onto the shell there. The next thing that we can take away is the side skirt armour. And that just very simply pulls off. By doing that, we reveal the detail of running gear. Very nice. Torsion bar suspension. Yeah. And a sprocket front and rear, and a set of guide wheels along the top, as well as the six road wheels. And then if we do the same on this side, there you go. So you've now got the tank in its kind of, in its alternate look, you could almost say. This is a fully functional version of a tank. You don't need the pannier boxes, you don't need the skirt armour. So if you wanted to change the look of your vehicle, you know, you certainly can do so. The next thing we'll do is, we'll take the tour off again. So these, I've not glued these on, the towing cables, for obvious reasons. There you go. That's where I was saying where you super glue the nylon cord onto the underside of the towing lug. We've got the same on the other side, so I'll take that off as well. Now, I mentioned earlier, if you see here, you can see there's some detail of a grey part visible through this, and this just lifts away and reveals this, which looks like some sort of generator block, perhaps like an APU, auxiliary power unit. As we're passing, we can see we've got the clear parts on the prism for the driver's position. And the same, we also get the same here. So yeah, very good. There are a pair of rear compartment vents, which can slide open there. Doesn't reveal any detail, but you know, that's interesting. Interesting nonetheless. Yeah. So there's a few things you can very easily do there to tear, kind of like to change the look of a tank and modify it. And with it being push fit, it's all dead easy to do these changes. Now, I guess if you were going to finely paint this, you might, and use it as a, primarily as a, say, a gaming model, you might want something a bit more robust. So you may decide that you don't want the kit to be so dismantleable. So you might just want to glue more of these parts together for more security. Right, so I'll put that back on, and I'll clip this one back on. And I think that pretty much concludes my overview of the build and the actual kit itself. But yeah, genuinely fun to make, and as I said, this is the first Bandai push fit kit I've made, and I'm very impressed. You know, Bandai, the precision on these kits is excellent to be able to do a push fit. One tip, actually, and I forgot this, one little tip with building. When I was putting this together, the front and the rear rotor wheels, they have a slightly different torsion bar that they're going to attach to. And I found the fit on these, on the, because they've got polycaps inside the wheels, I found the push fit to be too tight to safely do just straight off a bat. So the way I got around it is I just got some penetrating oil, so some WD-40, sprayed it on a cloth and just put the smallest wipe around the axle bar and then slid the road wheel on. And that just worked perfectly to allow it to fit rather than putting it under undue pressure. So I think that was the only... that was the only bit where I had to do anything other than just push it together. That was the only one like that I had. And the other thing is, there's the rear sprocket wheels have got a hexagonal inner, and you have to put the hexagonal inners at the rear because they're slightly wider than the ones at the front. And being in Japanese, I didn't quite pick that up when I was building it from the visual, but that was the only tricky bit I had. The instructions were very, very good, and we'll have a quick look over those next. So let's put this back together. Okay, then there's one final option on the vehicle in terms of its layout, and that's with these, the gun transit brackets. So I've just pulled these stowed versions off, and then you also get deployed versions, and again these just push fit on like so, dead easy, and then you can swing the gun turret round. And there's a pair of locator lugs that just very neatly drop in, and then your tank is now configured for transport. So another way to display the vehicle. Yeah, and it's lovely having those choices. And again, it just speaks of the care and thoughtfulness that's gone into the design of this kit. Okay, right, that's the actual kit talked about. I'm going to now, let's now just look over the other parts and instructions briefly. I mean, the instructions are very good, and as this is a Japanese import, they are in Japanese, so apart from the Arabic number system, everything, there's no English. So, but the instructions are excellent, and you won't go wrong anywhere. This bit here I figured out. I was trying to work out what it meant. What it's telling you is if you want your wheels to rotate so you can run your track, you need to cut these little nubs off the polycaps that go inside the wheels. And if you cut those off, then they'll rotate. If you leave them on, then it'll stop it rolling. I didn't want mine to roll, so I left them on. Anything else on the instructions? No, I mean, I think, given that, you know, you're working all off the diagrams, instructions are excellent. Really, really very good. And one really nice, neat touch with this, and again, it speaks of the kit quality in the sort of way that I think this is sort of like a bit of a special edition or a bit of a premium kit, is that certain parts of the construction, so here we have the side skirt arm going on the hull, but we have these little artist sketches of what they imagine the internal positions of a vehicle to look like. So this is a driver's position, and that's the tank commander's position. And these, you know, they're just really nice little touches. And there's a few of those throughout. I mean, here's one about showing you how the ladder can be deployed on the rear of a turret basket. And here's one again of the inside of, this is the gunner's position. I like this one in particular, and we'll come back to this as well in terms of what I think it shows. That shows the autoloader for the main gun. And I know I say it's an autoloader because having watched a few of the anime clips, it does show an autoloading mechanism operating. Yeah. And then you get painting ideas as well, like pro modeler tips. You get some very, very, very fine detail parts. So these are the, you get a set of crew, so they come in, it says three-part sprue, colour sprue, you get pale flesh, earth brown body, and then a maroon beret, so paratrooper style. You get a set of decals, water slide transfers. There are a number of spare accessories. This is the weapon sprue that the light and heavy machine guns came on. So you get some pistols, holstered and otherwise. You get some equipment pouches, other small pouches, and there's a deployed bipod and a spare ammunition magazine for the light machine gun. Then you also get some spares on the etched metal parts. So firstly, you get two spare chains for the grenade dispenser caps, which is good because you could go wrong putting those on, so you got a couple of get outs. And you even get these, I mean, look at these, are dog tags for the soldier minute, for the tank crew miniatures. And then these, if I've not put these on because I just think for myself they might get damaged using it in games, but these are actually sights for the machine guns. You've got a fore and aft sight as well, so yeah, really impressive details. Okay, so let's talk a bit about design cues on this tank. And I think this is a lovely vehicle for just thinking about where the design has come from. So the first thing, as I said earlier, is the arrangement. So the turret is at the rear of a tank. So that's suggesting it's a front engine tank. Although it does have these exhausts here, it still looks like a front engine tank. And this is quite an unusual layout, but it is used in the modern day Merkava battle tanks. They have this engine in the front, turret at the rear setup, and they also have this rear door system as well, which mirrors this tank. So yeah, there's a clear influence there from the modern day Merkava with the basic layout of this vehicle. Main guns, so we've got these big anti-tank rifles, interesting mix of sources. So these big chunky fume extractors remind me of the M1A2 style Abrams tank. They have these big bulbous fume extractors, much like this. However, when we look at the when we have a look at the muzzle of the gun, these sights are very reminiscent of British 120mm rifled guns from the likes of the Challenger tanks. So there's a couple of different modern tanks that have, you can see the designs have brought into this. I really like how they've done that. What else have we got with this? Now, when I was originally looking at this, I thought, oh, a big turret. So it has got an enormous turret. I mean, look at the size of it. And the size, the enormous turret makes sense for these, this pair of huge high-velocity cannon, which, you know, as I say, they look sort of like 150mm sized. So really massive guns. And the turret is of a similar size. But when I was looking at it, it took me a while to notice, but I actually, it occurred to me that the turret has been styled on a battleship turret, and you can see, and it, I just think that because of this, this sort of this turret ring structure, and how that sort of, how that's been built up. And if you've ever seen a picture of a turret on a battleship or a say a heavy cruiser, this, the design of this, it does make me think of that style of turret. You know, and makes me, you know, it makes me think, you know, a bit like a land battleship, isn't it? I do like that little design cue there. So yeah, while it is a futuristic science fiction tank, there's I like the real world elements that have been brought into it, and it adds to the authenticity of the whole thing. I think now we should do some size comparisons on this vehicle. So I'm going to do the size comparisons in two ways. I'm first going to do a size comparison against a 1/35th scale vehicle, because of course this is true 1/35th scale. So I think, kind of like from a military modeling point of view, I think that'd be a nice comparison to make. Then I'm going to compare it to a number of Warhammer 40,000 Horus Heresy vehicles. So I know you guys would be interested to see that. When I was thinking what to compare it to 1/35th style, most of my 1/35th tanks are long gun. However, when I was up in the Leaky Cheese storeroom, I did come across something which was just right, and it's a converted tank I made many years ago. And this is actually, and we've been talking about this tank, I was talking about this tank earlier in the review. This is a Merkava. I think it's a Merkava Mark II. It's a Tamiya model that I bought and converted for a sci-fi game many, many years ago. This is a perfect 1/35th comparison. So yes, the M61A5 is a very large tank. It is significantly taller than the Merkava. Let's just work on the shot there. So those are lined up tail to tail. It's probably about 15% longer. So it's quite a lot longer. It's much taller. It's more, this huge turret makes it really tall. And again, that makes sense given the size of those guns. It makes sense why the turret is so tall. And then width-wise, it'd be a little bit trickier to do. But well, if we ignore the sponson armor, not the spon, if we ignore the skirt armor as best we can, it's not quite so drastic on the width front. It's probably only about, I don't know, it's probably only around 10% wider. So it's proportionately longer than it is wider. But yeah, so that's a comparison against a 1/35th scale vehicle. But, you know, it's an enormous tank. It really is a huge tank. So let's now move to the 31st millennium and do some comparisons against 30k vehicles. Well, I suppose you should start with an infantryman and a member of the Adeptus of the Mechanicum has volunteered to help us out. So here we have a Titan Tech Priest. Yeah, it's big. It's very big, isn't it? So I'm not going to bother with any more infantry comparisons just because of the sheer size of it. So let's start with
a small armoured vehicle, and we will bring the Mark 1C Deimos Rhino in. Yeah. I mean, I think the best size comparison I can make between these two is to say that the Rhino is actually smaller, really, than the turret, excluding the guns, than the turret of the Hardgraph. So, yeah, you can go Rhino if you don't even qualify as for starting place on this comparison. Okay, let's move up to a Land Raider next. So we've been joined by my Land Raider Achilles Alpha, the tank that doesn't want to die. Still looking enormous. I mean, the Land Raider height-wise, the top of Land Raider comes up about to the base of the turret. Width-wise, I mean, the Land Raider isn't as wide as the Macava was. Sorry, they can't see that very well there. No, but so it's got a whole, the whole width of the track is extra compared to the Land Raider's hull. If you include the sponsons, however, if you're sort of like thinking about getting it through a tight gap, then there's actually not much in it. And I guess in that respect, the Hardgraph doesn't do bad for its size at all. And lengthwise, so those are tail to tail now. The Hardgraph is a third longer, so half as long again, let's say. So the Hardgraph is half as long again as the Land Raider. So the Land Raider is a better start, but I think the only thing that's going to give us anything meaningful as a size comparison is a Marine Super Heavy tank. And for that, we've got the Legion Glaive. So this is the largest tank that the Marines field. And now we've got vehicles of a comparable class. So the height-wise, the Glaive is a little bit taller. Yeah, probably a little bit taller than the Hardgraph. Width-wise, they are, if you include the skirt armour, then you can't really see it from there, but I'm, because of a camera effect, but if you include the skirt armour, then they're equivalent width. However, the sponsons make the Glaive substantially wider. And if we just do a length comparison as well, so we'll do tail to tail again, and doing that, well, track to back of power pack and mudguard to mudguard on the Hardgraph, they are the same length actually. So yeah, size wise the Hardgraph compares directly to either a Fellblade chassis Imperial Space Marine tank, so the Glaive, the Fellblade, or the Falchion, and then it would also directly compare in size to a Baneblade chassis tank as well. So when I originally picked this up, I looked at it and I thought, this is about the right size for a Macarius. I was definitely wrong. It's the right size to represent anything Baneblade chassis wise, and equally it's the right size to be a Fellblade or a Falchion, in particular with the double barrel cannons. Now, I guess playing it in 40k, if you wanted to use it as a model, if you're using it as any of those marine tanks which are supposed to have sponson weapons, then you need to think about how you represent that in place, because the sponsons have a game role defining the line of fire of those weapons, so you would need to consider that. But I guess you could, if you wanted, you could convert it. A big beast. And when you consider the size of it, and
in effect, it is a Bane blade or a glaive fell blade size vehicle, then the price tag I paid, so that was £97 UK sterling, is good. You know, a Bane blade from GW costs £85, and then of course if you go for a glaive, fell blade, etc., you're looking at £175 plus, because of course they're resin kits, so they're more expensive accordingly. I think in terms of comparing the price to the Bane blade, I would actually say it compares well. You know, this is a more sophisticated plastic model on account of the whole push fit system, and it's more precisely machined, and you've also got all the premium quality details such as the nylon ropes. And then the etched metal parts as well. I think that concludes this epic review of this epic vehicle. I think if you're interested in science fiction tanks, and even if you just enjoy making 1/35th military scale tanks, it's an excellent model, and I've had, as I say, a lot of fun making it, and I'm delighted that I bought it now. So it's a lovely model. And then in terms of thinking, you know, my original question that I set out to answer was, could I use this as part of a 30K force for survivors of the dark age of technology? Well, yes, I probably can. It will be a Baneblade chassis vehicle. I hope you've enjoyed this review of the M61A5 main battle tank by Bandai. I'll be fascinated to hear what you think in the comments. Do you have any other observations on its design, or what might have influenced the look of it, or perhaps something you might know something about it actually in the Gundam lore. So yeah, anyway, be interested to hear. Thank you very much for watching. I'll speak to you next time, and goodbye.